Good morning to everyone. Shall we all bow in prayer, welcoming our Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. To be enthroned on our praises. Hallelujah. The one and only, the maker of the universe. Hallelujah. Who takes pleasure in our worship. Hallelujah. What a privilege it is to stand before the throne of Almighty, Omnipotent God. Hallelujah. Who is everywhere. Hallelujah. Who has lifted us. Who has cleansed us, who has made us from being sinners to be His children. Hallelujah. In Christ Jesus, to be co-heirs. Hallelujah. Oh, what an awesome presence of the Lord it is. The same presence, hallelujah, which created all the earth. The same presence was lifted Jesus alive. The same presence is here in our midst. Hallelujah. As we call on the name, He has promised to be in our midst. Hallelujah. As we worship together, as we unite our hearts, hallelujah, in sweet surrender, He has promised to be right in front of us. Hallelujah. Taking pleasure. Hallelujah. Blessing us. Hallelujah. Providing us strength and courage to face the day. Hallelujah. Lord, our hearts are yearning for You, Father. Fill us. We are thirsty for You. Oh Lord, we place You on the highest place. For You are the great High Priest. We place You high above. Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, our hearts are yearning for You. We ask You to fill us today. Shall we sing Hosanna?
Pray.
all lift our voices and sing praise.
Sing praise. Sing praise. We sing it. Sing praise. Sing praise. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For His goodness is above all things. His love endures forever.
Mighty one, on the throne, king of all and God alone. You're my shield, you're my song, mighty conqueror in control.
Mighty one, on the throne, king of all.
praise you. Yes, my praise releases the power of God. I will praise you. Praise the worship him. Hallelujah. Though there has been, hallelujah, difficult situations, God has brought us together in worship today. Hallelujah. He has spared us with his grace and love. Hallelujah. So that we can worship him together as church. Hallelujah. What a mighty God who we serve, who can make, hallelujah, valleys. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who can make deserts into rivers for us. Hallelujah. Make ways there is no way. Hallelujah. Do wonders and marvelous deeds. Hallelujah for us. Oh, shall we proclaim? God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we cannot see.
Of
You alone can save us. You alone can lift us. You alone can heal us, Father. We surrender in your mighty hands. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Praise God. I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It gives me great pleasure for me and my wife Preeti here to greet you all once again and declare the blessing of God over you even in this very new month. This month of November, God has given us a wonderful promise from the book of Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. The Bible says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and be courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." And this morning, what a wonderful promise God has given us. We are going to meditate upon this particular verse of scripture during this sermon, but I want to say those words of encouragement over you. Be strong, be courageous, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you. He has been with us so far, and that is the very reason that we are alive this very morning. And He who has led us this far, He will also lead us till the end. Even this month of November, this particular week, we have wonderful opportunities for us to partake in the Word of God, to worship God, and to pray. Wednesdays we have our midweek service, and Friday is our fasting prayer. All these things will happen online, and we encourage you to make use of this wonderful opportunity. Coming 11th of this particular month, November, it's a Wednesday. By God's grace and with very much of prayers and considerations, we are opening our church for worship once again, starting the 11th of November, which is this month. On the 11th, midweek service, and following Friday, we will have the fasting prayer. 15th Sunday, our church will be open for worship. On the 8th of November, we will be able to give you the specific rules and regulations that we need to follow in order for us to come together as a church. And after so much time of patient waiting, we thank God for this wonderful opportunity to come together, and we trust the promises of God, and we find our rest and our assurance in His Word. And I'm sure the Lord, as He has given this wonderful promise, be strong, be courageous. The Lord is going to be with us. And I encourage you to pray towards this particular effort that we take, so that it will all work out well for the glory of God and for the blessing of God's people. If you are going to celebrate your birthdays and your wedding anniversaries this month of November, it gives us great privilege for us to pray for you. My wife Preeti is going to pray for you, that the Lord will crown this particular year with His goodness and with His blessing. Let's all pray together wherever we are.
Loving Father, we give thanks for your love and grace which has sustained us so far. And Lord, in this new month, bless your people with good health and protection. And Lord, lead them, guide them in the way forward. And Lord, let them be untouched by evil. And Lord, we pray for those who are celebrating their birthdays and wedding anniversaries, that Lord, crown them with your goodness. We pray that all the promises which you have pronounced over their lives be fulfilled in this new year. Yes. And whatever they have prayed for, let that prayer be answered according to your will. And Lord, let your will be done in their lives, and let your name be glorified in and through their lives. And Lord, bless your people in every way and in everything. We commit our lives into your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We declare the blessing of God over you. We pray goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. What a privilege it is for us this morning to partake of the communion. The Bible says, do this in remembrance of me. What a wonderful Savior we have in Jesus Christ, and what He has accomplished on the cross for each one of us, so that we can experience the goodness of God, the blessing of God in and through salvation in Jesus Christ. I'm sure you are prepared in your homes to partake of the communion, and I encourage you to just bow your heads as we look to God in worship this morning, just as we reflect upon what He has done for each one of us on the cross of Calvary. The Bible says that the chastisement for our well-being came upon Him, and by His stripes we are healed. He took our sorrows, He took our pain, and He has carried them away on the cross of Calvary, so that you and I can experience the blessing of God, the favor of God upon each one of our lives. Let's lift our hands and thank God for this wonderful gift of salvation. It is by grace, it is through faith, it is through what Christ has accomplished on the cross of Calvary. Not that we can boast, because it is not from us, it is from Him. And He alone is worthy of all our praise and all our worship this morning. Hallelujah. Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and unto the Lamb sing praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power and strength. Be to our God forever. Thank you, you made the first move. And we are so thankful this morning for what Christ has accomplished for each one of us on the cross of Calvary. As we partake of the communion, we pray that you will bless your people, Lord, in a very special way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. God's people say, Amen. In the night that Christ was betrayed, the Bible says He took bread, and he gave thanks, he broke it, and he said, partake of this. This is my body that is broken for you. I want you to partake even as we are partaking here, to remember what Christ has done for each one of us. This is my body that is broken for you. And in the same way, he took the cup and he said, partake of this. This is the blood of the new covenant which has been shed for the remission of sins. As often as you do it in remembrance of me. This is the blood of Christ that is shed for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship you, Father. Worship you, Father. Thank you for the redemption that we have in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you gave your life as a ransom for each one of us, that we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And we, the redeemed, shall be strong in purpose and unity, declaring aloud, singing praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and power. This morning, declare the blessing of your to be upon your people. It's in Jesus' name God's people say, Amen. Praise the Lord, and the Lord bless you richly this morning. Let's turn our Bibles to Psalm 143 and verse 10 as we continue to study the Word of God this very morning. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful morning. Thank you for the privilege, Lord, of worshiping you, of partaking in the communion, even in the first day of this very new month. We thank you for new grace. We thank you for the new anointing with fresh oil, as your word says. Lord, this morning we pray that you will speak into our hearts, and Lord, that you will inspire, Lord, us with your word and fill us with your strength that only you can bring into our hearts. I pray that you will be glorified as we study your word. It's in Jesus' name God's people say, Amen, Amen. This is a wonderful prayer that we've been studying for a very long time from Psalm 143 and verse 10, where David prays that your good Holy Spirit will lead us forward. Even as we enter the new month this very morning, we can only look back and reflect in the past 10 months how God wonderfully has led us this far. Challenging times, times of uncertainty, times of difficulty, times of weakness. In the midst of all such challenges, the Bible wonderfully has, God has spoken into our hearts, and the Word of God has guided us this far. The Bible says, His Word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, and He has led us forward by His Word through His Spirit in our hearts. And even this very morning, as we've entered a new month, the Lord is going to lead us forward, you know, through by His Word, with His presence, and he's going to take us from where we are to where we need to be. We've been looking at the life of Isaac, again facing similar or in a different, you know, scenario where he's going through a year of famine. Even as the famine has come to an end, you know, he can gladly say that the Lord has led me forward and not backwards, even in the midst of challenging times. How does the Lord do that? We've been studying from 2 Corinthians 8, where the Bible says he provides his grace. And it is the grace of God that gives us the privilege to know him and also the privilege to be part of his plan. And Paul says, I want to press on towards the plan of God. I want to pursue towards the purposes of God in my life. And how does the Lord, you know, help us do that? Remember, as we reflect upon what we studied last week, you know, our spiritual walk or our pilgrimage or our spiritual life is compared to a race. And even as we run that race with joy, we inevitably face up with challenges. We have to deal with burdens and we have to deal with hindrances in our life. How does the Lord help us to deal with them even as he leads us forward? Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1, we are going to read that wonderful verse of scripture this morning. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every encumbrance or every burden and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. And here we find the writer to the Hebrews says that we have to lay aside every hindrance or in every encumbrance or every weight that seems to bring us down. We need to lay aside, meaning we have to deal with them and continue to run the race that God has chosen for each one of us. How do we deal with the burdens, especially if the burden is something that is in our heart, something that is bothering us in our mind? And last week we looked at how the Word of God, you know, helps us, or the Word of God which is divinely empowered, you know, the Word being in our heart and being in our mouth is how we take every thought captive and bring it to the subjection of Jesus Christ. And that is why we looked at this wonderful verse from Joshua chapter 23 and verse 14, where Joshua says, you know, your God, the Lord your God, you know, all the good words that the Lord your God spoke concerning you, none has failed, but all have come to its fulfillment. That good word that the Lord has spoken over you, your family, in regard to your future, in regard to your work, whatever the Lord has promised and spoken those things over you, that particular word needs to be in your heart, it needs to be in your mouth, and it is through that that we take everything, every thought captive, you know, and bring it to the subjection of Jesus Christ. We are going to continue to study, you know, from that particular angle. The Bible says, let this word not depart from your mouth, you know, meditate upon it day and night, and then you will make your way prosperous and you will have good success, says the Word of God. Come with me to Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. How does the Lord help us move forward in life? This is the word of promise for this month also, and we are going to study this particular word, and may the Lord speak to our hearts and bless our lives immensely. Joshua chapter 1 and verse 9. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Key words, have I not commanded you? Or have I not, you know, said these words to you? Have I not spoken to you? You know, be strong, be courageous. Do not be discouraged. Do not be afraid. I will be with you wherever you go. These are the words that was given to Joshua as the Lord leads him forward from where he is to the place where God wants him to be. Challenging times, you know, we can identify with Joshua in many ways, because here he finds himself, you know, at the verge of a miracle, so to speak, at the verge of entering into the land of Canaan. But, you know, it is a sense of, a place where he can say, I have been there before. Because literally 40 years ago, when Moses was leading the people of Israel, they came up to this particular place. And the Bible gives us an account of what happened then. Moses sends 12 spies to spy out the land, and 12 spies, they go, they spend 40 days, and they look around the city, they taste the food, and bring back the fruit, and they say it's a wonderful country, and so many good things are there, but nevertheless, they bring a very bad report, in the sense that we can never take this city, we can never, be part of it, because, it is fortified, and the people there are like giants, and we are like grasshoppers in their eyes, and so on and so forth. And when the people heard this bad report, the Bible says their hearts melted, and they, instead of believing in God to face up to this challenge, they began to murmur against God, they began to murmur against godly leadership. As a result of that, they came so close, but they were yet so far from experiencing the promise of God in their lives. Out of the 12 spies, only 2, Joshua and Caleb, gave a good report. These are the men who were faithful. These are the men who said, if God be our side, be on our side, if God is our help, we can easily take this land. But their voice was not, loud enough, if I could put it in that way, because the bad report was so loud. And as a result of that, the people had to walk back into the wilderness, and for 40 long years they have been wandering from here and there, and after such a long time they come back again to this point, that Joshua has already been there once. Probably a lot of things going through his mind. Added to that, Moses is no more, and he's facing a big challenge. He needs to lead these people beyond the Jordan into the promised land. He needs to overcome 31 kings. Not only that, he needs to divide the promised land among the 12 tribes, which is difficult, facing his own challenges in his mind, or defeating the 31 kings, or even dividing the land between the 12 tribes. Everything seems to be, overwhelming. He seems to be facing a greater challenge in his life. There are thoughts in his mind, I have been here and I know what happened last time. I have been here, I know we faced with failure and everything was put off for another 40 years. Will that the same thing happen again in my life? Will I crumble under pressure? Will I just quit because things are too difficult? It is in that particular juncture that God begins to speak into Joshua's life, and he says, have I not commanded you? Have I not said these wonderful words to you? Have I not given you the promise? He says, be strong and be courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, because I am going to be with you wherever you go. Putting it in another way, it all depends on what God has said. It all depends on how we have understood. Because if you know what God has said, that will give us the strength to overcome, our discouragement. If you know what the Lord has said, those words will drive the fear out of our hearts and bring courage into our lives, so that we can move forward in the things of God. And the key word that I would like to focus this very morning is this: have I not commanded you? To put it in another way, have I not said these words to you? Have I not told you this before? In other words, these are not words that God is saying, to make us look as if, do you not understand, or, you of little faith, and so on. Not in that sense, but rather it is a reminder saying, you can do it, because I have given you the promise. I am going to be with you. I am going to lead you forward, and you are going to, divide this land between the 12 tribes. You are going to be victorious, because I have already given you the promise. Our focus this morning is this: have I not commanded you, or have I not said these words to you already? God is a God of his word. And the Bible says he is the Word. The Bible says in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And whatever he has done, he has always done it, he has accomplished through his Word. Just take Genesis 1 for example. The Bible starts, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Before he spoke any word, the Bible says the earth was void, it was formless, it was empty, and darkness was there. And he took such a thing, and by the end of the particular chapter, you will find, you know, wonderful creations have come to existence, and the earth and the fullness thereof belongs to the Lord. And if I could summarize that first chapter of Genesis, it goes in this way: God said it, and it was very good. Let me say those words again for you. God said it, and it was so. It was very good. You know, in other words, whatever he said, it came to pass, and whatever came to pass was very good. You know, these words needs to be written upon our hearts this morning. God said it, it was so, and it was very good. And based on that, if you look at what God spoke to Joshua, have I not told you? Have I not spoken to you? Have I not commanded you? Because whatever God says, it becomes so, and it ends up as being very good. And let me tell you, he is the unchanging God this morning. Whatever he has spoken to you, whatever he has spoken over your family, whatever he has spoken over our church, it will become so. And at the end of it, we are going to say, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. We are going to go through a wonderful verses of scripture this morning. Every scripture, I pray that it will minister to your heart. It will minister to your specific circumstances, because the word will never return empty. The word will always accomplish its purpose. God said it, and it was so. And the end of it, the Bible says, it was all wonderful. It was really beautiful. He makes all things beautiful in his time. And the focus this morning is his word. Every word that he speaks, every word that he has already spoken over our lives. No wonder Joshua, having experienced the wonderful work of God, towards the end of his life, he says, every good word that he spoke, you know, not even one has failed, but everything has come to its fulfillment. Look at how God uses his word to bring about changes, to bring about, you know, his purposes into play. Come with me to Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. We're going to look at how God's word can bring about transformation and change in our situations and in our lives. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. The Bible says, and he is the radiance of his glory, the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. When he had made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Key words that needs to be underlined: he upholds all things by the word of his power. Say those words together with me again: uphold all things by the word of his power. In other words, if you look at that particular verse of scripture, everything that he has created, he also sustains them, or he upholds them by the power of his word. The Bible reads. What does it mean when the Bible says he upholds? It means he maintains and he also propels. In other words, if just mere maintenance is done, whatever is today will be the same even when you come to the next year. But the Bible says he upholds all things by the word of his power. It means he not only maintains, but he also propels, meaning he makes it move forward, you know, and that particular truth is very important to our lives. He has sustained us this far. And let me encourage you this morning, not only has God sustained us this far, he has also, you know, led us forward. Just make reflections in the past 10 months of this very year. how we all started it and how things all began to change and how we have passed through difficult circumstances and so many challenges. You know, through it all, God not only sustained us, but He has also led us forward. And how does He do that? The Bible says that He upholds all things by the word of His power. And let me encourage you this morning, He who has sustained you this far, He will also propel you or lead you forward. Remember what Jeremiah says, the very fact that we are not consumed, it's by the grace of God. Not only are we sustained until now, the Bible says He will also move us forward. That is why we keep saying these words again and again and again. When the grace of God will take us from where we are to where we need to be in God, and He maintains us, He upholds us, He also propels us or causes us to move forward in the things of God. He does it all through the power of His word. Romans chapter 4 and verse 17. Have I not told you? Have I not commanded you? What are the words that God has already spoken? How do they work wonders in our lives? Look at this particular verse of scripture. Romans chapter 4 and verse 17. As it is written, a father of many nations have I made you, in the presence of him who he believed, even God, who gives life to the dead and calls into being that which does not exist. Powerful words of God. Let me read it for you again. Calls into being that which does not exist. You know, this is a verse of scripture describing, you know, the life of Abraham and how he has put his trust in God. You know, have I not told you? Have I not commanded you? You know, and when God called Abraham, he said, surely I'm going to bless you. I'm going to multiply you. And I'm going to make you a blessing to many nations. And he's given wonderful promises. But many, you know, even though God has given so many wonderful promises, there was something that was lacking, you know, in Abraham and Sarah's life. They still haven't got a child of their own. You know, and there is no, you know, generation or the blessing of God to come into their lives. They need to experience, you know, the birth of a child. But that was lacking in their lives for many years. But as Paul summarizes Abraham's life, you know, he says, Abraham put his faith in God. And what kind of God is he? The Bible says he calls into existence that which does not exist. You know, putting it in another way, when God calls that which does not exist, it comes into existence. And that is why God, you know, at one particular juncture, he changed the name of Abram from Abram to Abraham. Abram means father. Abraham means father of many nations. When he called him the father of many nations, literally speaking, he did not have a child. But when the word of God's promise came into Abraham's life, and as he believed in that word of God, as I told you, when God calls, even that which does not exist comes into existence the moment God calls. And let me encourage you again this morning, He is the same yesterday, He is the same today, and He is the same forever. And if He can call things into existence, that which does not exist, let me encourage you, He can do the same in your life even today. Whatever is lacking in your life, whatever needs to be there, but it is not there. When God calls things, even though they don't exist, they come into existence because His word has creative power. His word brings into existence things that doesn't exist, and that is why the focus is on what He has said. The focus is on what He has spoken, and that is why we keep going back to this wonderful promise. Have I not commanded you? Be strong. I know things are lacking, but have I not commanded you? What kind of God that we worship? He calls things into existence that doesn't even exist. The moment this word comes out of His mouth, The Bible says things come into existence. Whatever is lacking in your life this very morning, even if it is regarding finance, regarding relationship, regarding peace of mind, regarding health, regarding whatever aspect of life, if God has already spoken those words, you know, those good words that He has already spoken needs to be in your heart, it needs to be in your mouth, and even as you speak what God has spoken, that which is lacking in your life will come to a place where you will be able to overflow with the blessing of God. To use the expression of the psalmist David, you know, surely my cup runs over, my cup overflows, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Abraham put his trust in God, who calls things into, who calls into existence that which does not exist. His word brings those things into existence as He speaks them. And that is why the Bible says, God says to Joshua, have I not spoken to you? Have I not commanded you? And this morning I want you to be encouraged. You know, just reflect upon whatever promise God has already, you know, spoken over your lives. Those things will come into existence. Those things will come to its fulfillment. Those things will come to pass in your life, because the God of Abraham today is the God of you and is the God of each one of us. Psalm 33 and verse 9. Look at this wonderful, powerful verse of scripture. Psalm 33 and verse 9. The Bible says, for He spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. Powerful word of God. He spoke and it was done deal, to use the expression. He commanded and it stood fast. Such is the power of God's word. And that is why He said, have I not commanded? You know, He commanded and it stood fast. He spoke and it was done. Remember the instance in the Bible where the disciples were in the boat. Jesus was also in the boat. And suddenly a storm, you know, began to brew and things became very difficult. And at one point, you know, they thought they are all going to die. And so they wake up Christ and they say, do you not care that we are perishing? And at that moment, the Bible says, Jesus stood up in the boat and he rebuked the storm. And there was calm and quietness, the Bible records. You know, that is what it means when the Bible says He spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood firm. This morning, we may not be literally in the midst of a storm, but there are life's circumstances that seems to be like a storm, that seems to be difficult. I tried to manage, I tried to handle, but it has been so overwhelming, and a thought comes to my mind that God does not care even if I am perishing. But let me encourage you this morning, we have a God of purpose who causes all things to work together for good to those who are called according to His purpose and to those who love God. And the God of purpose will intervene in your circumstance. He will stand, so to speak, in as He stood in the boat, you know, with the disciples and calm the storm. I say to you this morning, He is with you and He will intervene, and as His word proceeds, there will be a calm in the midst of, you know, turmoil and in the midst of storm. Such is the power of God's word. Such is the power that proceeds from the word of God. And that is why God seems to, you know, say to Joshua, have I not spoken? Have I not commanded? Come with me to another verse. Isaiah chapter 55 and verse 11. Powerful, wonderful word of God. Isaiah 55, 11, the Bible says, so will my word be, which goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter for which I have sent it. Why are we looking at all these words of scripture? The Bible says, have I not commanded you? Every word that comes out of the mouth of God brings about a godly change in this circumstance. I'm going to say those words again for you. Every word that God speaks brings about a godly change. Now that word needs to be in your heart and it needs to be in your mouth. And when it is spoken, believing in our heart and confessing with our mouth will bring about a godly change in our circumstance also. And that is why the focus is upon God and His word. And what does He say concerning His own word? We have just read it in Isaiah 55:11. He says, "My word will never return empty to me. It will always accomplish what I desire, and it will always succeed in the matter for which I have sent it." And let me encourage you this morning. The word of God in no way will return empty. It will no way return void. It will always accomplish what He desires. And let me encourage you again this morning. His desire for you is much more greater. His plan that He has for you is much more greater than the plan you have for yourself. The very beginning of this particular year, you know, God gave us a wonderful promise where He says that it is according to His pleasure He will prosper Zion. You know, according to His pleasure, according to His desire over our lives, He will bring about prosperity, meaning wholeness in our life. And the Bible here says, whatever I desire, my word will always accomplish it. It will always succeed, you know, in the mission that I have sent it. You know, if that is the power of God's word, the Bible says, the promise that is given to us this very morning, have I not spoken these words? Have I not commanded? Because every word that I have said, it will never return empty. It will always accomplish what I desire. It will always succeed in the mission that I have sent it. John's Gospel, you will find a very beautiful example. John's Gospel chapter 4 and verse 50. If you read that particular word of scripture, you will find how the word of God, you know, accomplishes what God desires and succeeds in the matter that God has sent it. You know, the Bible says, Jesus said to him, "Go, your son lives." You know, the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and started off. Verse 51, the Bible reads, "And as he was now going down, his slaves met him, saying that his son was living." You know, it might be the story could have ended there, but the Bible says, gives us a beautiful account. Verse 52, the Bible reads, "So he inquired of them the hour when he began to get better. Then they said to him, 'Yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him.'" Verse 53, the Bible says, "So the father knew that it was at that hour in which Jesus said to him, 'Your son lives,' and he himself believed, and his whole household." What a wonderful, powerful, you know, example that the Bible has recorded for each one of us. You know, my word, it will never come back empty. It will always, you know, accomplish what I desire. A man comes to God, he says, "My son is not well," you know, and he says, "Go, your son lives." The man trusts in the word of God and he makes his journey back. And the Bible gives us such a beautiful account when his slaves, you know, come towards him. They say, "Your son is alive, he's better, the fever has left him." But what an interesting question that the father is asking. He says, "At what time, you know, did the fever leave him?" And they tell him the time, and he remembers that it was that very time when God spoke those words, and the very time where the child also got better. Why did God has recorded all these incidents for you and for me? You know, these things happened years and years and years ago. But this very morning we are looking at the very verse of scripture. Why does God remind us of this particular verse of scripture? It is to remind us that God's word will never return empty. Maybe a thought comes to your mind. God spoke today and the very moment, you know, that person got well, but my situation is very difficult. You know, for 5 years, 10 years and 15 years, I'm just going through the same problem. and nothing seems to be happening. You know, when I come across the instances where God instantly heals people, you know, I long for such an experience, but it seems to be the opposite in my life. But nevertheless, let me encourage you again. We need to stick to the word of God, which says that His word will never return empty. It will always accomplish what He desires. You know, maybe, you know, it did not happen in the same way, like an instant healing or an instant change. But nevertheless, the God who has spoken His word, He will always bring it to pass. He will make all things beautiful and appropriate in His time. All we need to do is put our faith in God's word. And that is why He says to Joshua, "Have I not commanded you? Have I not told you?" You know, to put it in another way, you know, this promise that God gave to Joshua was first given to Abraham. You know, when God spoke to Abraham, He said, the very place that your feet treads upon, this land I'm going to give to you and to your descendants. Then Isaac came on the scene, and then Jacob came on the scene. Then for many, many years, they have been, you know, as slaves in Egypt. And God wonderfully led them out. And again, because of their unbelief, they had to do a lot of wanderings in the desert. Now comes a very pivotal moment. And God says the same word. You know, I'm going to give you this land. I have given you this land. You will be able to divide this land among the children of God. The point is this. What God spoke to Abraham, even it took centuries, it will never return void. By the end of the book of Joshua, we read these powerful words again. Every good word that the Lord spoke concerning you, not even one failed, but everything came to its fulfillment. Yes, it took a long time, but nevertheless, the point that needs to be stressed this morning, it's not how long it takes, it is how sure that the Lord always brings it to pass what He has already given as a promise through His word. The Bible says His word never returns empty. His word creates, it sustains, it propels. And when He says it is done, and when He commands, it stands still. Numbers chapter 23 and verse 19. We will come across another powerful aspect of God's word. God is not a man that He should lie, nor a son of man that He should repent, meaning change His mind. Has He said and will He not do it? Or has He spoken and will He not make it good? These are powerful words. God is not a man that He should lie, nor a son of man that He should repent. What does it mean? When do people, you know, lie? They give a word and they cannot keep the word. Therefore, they have to lie in order to cover up things. They need to lie in order to, you know, keep up their reputation and so on. And when do people change their minds? You know, maybe example, you know, in a joyous moment, they make a promise. And once the feeling goes and things return to normal, then they begin to realize whatever they have said, it's impossible to keep up. Therefore, they change their mind. And that is how it happens in the life of human beings. But the Bible says God is not a man that He should lie, nor is He a man to change His mind. Because when God says it, He's got all the power to bring it to pass. Therefore, there is no need for God to lie. There is no need for God to have to change His mind. Putting it in another way, you know, God gave a promise, for example, to Abraham, and then He thought about it. Oh, I have said it. You know, this is too much for me to do. Therefore, I'm going to trim those promises here and there, and I'm just going to give Him only this much. No, it is not going to happen. Because when God says it, as we have looked at it from the previous verses of Scripture, when He says, it is done. When He commands, it stands firm. And here the Bible says there is no need for God to lie, because He is not a man to lie, nor is He a human to change His mind. Maybe in your life, people lied to you, betrayed you, and that is why you ended up in the mess that you find yourself. Maybe people changed their minds, and because of them changing their mind, you ended up in a mess. And therefore, when God speaks to you, you just think, you know, He is going to be the same as these people and how they have treated you. But let me encourage you this morning. God is not a man, He is not a human to lie, nor is He a human to change His mind. Whatever He has purposed, He will always bring it to pass. That is what, you know, Job understood in his life. In the midst of challenges, in the midst of loss, in the midst of sickness, in the midst of so much of chaos in his life, he says these powerful words, Lord, You are an almighty God, and whatever You have purposed, You will always make it come to pass. In other words, if you have whatever You have said, it will never change, but You will change everything else so that they will be conformed to Your word. And this morning, the promises of God, they never change. Maybe you find yourself in a problem, you find yourself in a predicament, but let me encourage you again. God will change the problem so that His promises will stand true. He will change the situation so that the promise that was given through Scripture will come to its fulfillment. Because the Bible says He's a God of His word, and He says to you and to me, have I not spoken these words to you? Have I not given you the promise? Have I not commanded you? You know, be strong, be courageous, don't be afraid, you know, and don't be discouraged, because I don't lie and I don't change my mind, and whatever I have promised, whatever I have spoken, it will always come to pass, it will always succeed, and it will always, you know, accomplish the desire that I have for you. The Bible wonderfully gives us this blessed assurance. Come with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 6 and verse 4. What a wonderful word of promise here. This is Solomon speaking. He said, blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who spoke with His mouth to my father David and has fulfilled it with His hands, saying, key words, blessed be the Lord. He spoke with His mouth to my father and He has fulfilled it with His hands. You know, what a wonderful, wonderful picture this is. You know, this is Solomon saying, I praise the Lord, I give Him praise, I give Him worship, because He gave His word to my father David, but He has fulfilled it, you know, with His hands in my life. What does it say? You know, He's a God of generations. No wonder the Bible calls Him the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. What does it mean is this, whatever He has promised, you know, sometimes some promises, you know, they go beyond our lifetime. You know, yes, we have the foretaste of the promise, but our generations, our future generations, they are going to be blessed by the word that God speaks to you this very morning. That is why there is a powerful verse of scripture in Isaiah where God says to His people, my spirit that is upon you and my word that is in your mouth, it will not depart from your children and your children's mouth. What a wonderful promise that goes from generation to generation. My spirit that is upon you and my word that is in your mouth, it will not depart from your children's mouth and from the mouth of your children's children. Putting it in another way, we have the promise of God from generation to generation. And here Solomon says, you know, I thank God, I praise God, because whatever promise God gave to my father, I have come to see the fulfillment of it in my own life. You know, I can say it in this way, whatever God has promised to our parents, you know, we are experiencing that. And whatever God has promised to us, we will have a foretaste of it, and we will always, always can be assured that He will be a God, not only to us, but also to our future generations. And such is the Lord God, such is His promise, such is His word. He never changes, He never lies, and whatever He has promised, He will fulfill it in our generation and also in the generations to come. And that is why He says, have I not spoken these words to you? Have I not commanded these words to you? It will surely come to pass. Be strong, be courageous, don't look back, Don't look back at your past failures 40 years ago. Joshua, don't look back at the wanderings, but I want you to move forward, because have I not said these words? Have I not given you the promise? And what does the promise say? Don't be afraid, be strong, be courageous. And it also says, I will be with you. What a wonderful promise that is. Genesis chapter 28 and verse 15. There you find another instance and how the word of God is so special and so powerful. Behold, this is God speaking to Jacob. He says, behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. I'm going to read it again for you this morning. Powerful verses of scripture. Jacob is no longer here in 2020. It is you and me. Therefore, this particular verse of scripture is for you. It is for me. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. Doesn't mean we can go wherever we want. It means, you know, as life takes us along, he will be with us. I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Let me say it in this way. You know, does Jacob deserve such wonderful promise? You know, did God give this beautiful promise to Jacob because he was such a godly man, because he was a prayerful man, because he was a holy man? No. If you just look past, you know, look at his past, you know, he has just taken, you know, he has just, you know, deceived his brother of his birthright. Then he deceived his father, you know, given the circumstance that his father is blind. He took his blind father for a ride, and he, you know, by deception, he caused him to say, pronounce the blessing on him. And as a result of all these deceiving, you know, methods, he has to run away from home. And, you know, on the way, God intervenes in his life. That is a beautiful picture of grace. You know, grace is what God gives to those who don't deserve it. In other words, Jacob does not deserve, you know, the presence of God. He does not deserve the promise of God. He does not deserve an encounter with God like this. But nevertheless, God gives such a beautiful promise to him, not because he is worthy, but because he is unworthy. And that is why this very morning, you, no matter how bad your past might be, God is a God of grace. He's a God of mercy. The Bible says he can show mercy up to 1,000, you know, 1,000 generation. That is how rich our God is when it comes to mercy. And he says, Jacob, behold, I'm going to be with you. I will bring you back to this place of vision. And I will be with you, and I will not leave you until I have fulfilled all that I have promised you. Let me put it in this way. His very presence with us is the assurance that he will fulfill his promise to us. I'm going to say those words again for you. His very presence with us is the assurance that he will fulfill his promise to us. Let me ask a very simple question. Is the Lord with you? We can all say, yes, he is with us, because he will never leave us nor forsake us. Whether I feel or whether I don't feel his presence, he is always with me. And take that particular principle, apply that in this particular verse of scripture. I will not leave you until I fulfill all that I have promised you. Therefore, his very presence with us gives me the assurance that he who promised will always bring those promises to fulfillment in my life. The Lord is with you this morning. The Lord is with us this morning. You know, he is with us, and that gives us the sense of assurance that whatever he has spoken over our lives, he is with us to bring those promises to fulfillment in our lives. That is why when he spoke to Joshua, he said, have I not commanded you? I will be with you wherever you go. Be strong, be courageous, don't be afraid, don't be discouraged, because my very presence is an assurance that whatever I have promised, I will always bring it to pass in your life. No wonder the Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. This morning, as you are listening to the word of God, if God reminds you of the promise that he has made to you probably 5 years ago, probably 10 years ago, if God brings that to your mind this very morning as you are listening to the word of God, it shows that God is reminding you so that you will realize that he is working on those promises. He is bringing those promises to fulfillment. You know, I said it in the Tamil service in this way. அவர் உங்களுக்கு நினைப்பூட்டுவார் என்று சொன்னால் அதை நிறைவேற்றி கொண்டிருக்கிறார் என்ற அர்த்தம். If he reminds you of a promise, it simply means his word is making progress. He is accomplishing things in the background, so to speak. Behind the scenes, things are happening. Just because you can't see it, you know, with your natural eyes, it doesn't mean God has forgotten all about his promises. No, whatever he says, he will always bring it to pass. And if he reminds you of a promise, it only means that he is working on it. Those words are the promise. Is getting fulfilled, so to speak, behind your scenes. And one fine, wonderful day, you will say with the psalmist, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And this morning, I want you to take time after this service is finished. You know, I want you to take some time, sit back, and do some reflections. You know, let the Lord remind you of all the promises that he has given you so far. Maybe you can take a notebook and write down all those promises. You know, whatever God has promised you, some words of promise that he gave you right at the start of your wedded life, some promise that he has given you when your children were born, when you were at work, when you were finding yourself in difficult circumstances, whatever promise that God has given you, I pray that he will remind you so that you will have that blessed assurance that his very presence and his very reminding you of his promises is an indicator that God is fulfilling, is bringing those promises to fulfillment in our lives. And that is why he says, have I not spoken these words to you? I spoke these words to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to Moses. Now I'm saying these same words to you, and you are going to experience the power of the promise as you enter the promised land. And even this particular new month, God is going to bring his words to fulfillment. And the key, the aspect of it is that our focus needs to be on what he has said. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Why is the word important? One important scripture, John's Gospel chapter 6 and verse 63. Let me read it for you. John's Gospel chapter 6 and verse 63. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing, or the flesh accomplishes nothing, says another translation. The words that I have spoken to you are Spirit and life. Powerful word of God. It is the Spirit who gives life. The words that I have spoken to you are Spirit and life. You know, Tamil says it in a very different way. It brings things back to life, you know, and my words are full of spirit and they give life to you. Every word that he has spoken into our hearts, even our circumstances may seem, you know, like it is dead, it is gone, it is no more to be, you know, to come back to life. It has gone to such, you know, bad situation. But the Bible says, my word, it will bring back things to life. It will infuse life into dead circumstance. You will find a very prophetic, you know, account of that in the book of Ezekiel, where the prophet is made to stand in a valley of dry bones. And the Lord asks him a question. Do you think these dry bones will come to life? And the prophet says, Lord, only you know. And he said, I want you to prophesy, meaning I want you to say the words that I'm telling you. I want you to speak those words over these dry bones. By the end of the chapter, you will find the valley of dry bones is no longer a valley of dry bones, But all these, you know, the tremendous transformation takes place. And there stood a mighty army in the place of dry bones. What is the gist? What is the thrust of that particular chapter of God's word? It says, things might be as dead can be. But my words, they are spirit and they are life. They bring things into existence. They infuse life into them so that His word will come to its fruition in each one of our lives. And that is why the Bible says, this word that I have spoken over you, it needs to be in your mouth. It needs to be in your heart. Have I not spoken these words? I want you to speak those words and be strong, be courageous, move forward, for the Lord your God is with you. I'm just going to give you a few verses of scripture, you know, concerning, you know, our future, our family, our work, and, you know, our sin and so on, and so that you will be encouraged this very morning. Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18. Key aspect, have I not told you? What has he said concerning these particular aspects? Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18. The Bible says, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. You know, though your sins are as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be like wool. Wonderful, powerful word of God. Have I not told you? This morning we have partaken of the communion, and it is a declaration saying that our sins have been dealt with by Christ on the cross of Calvary. This is the blood of the new covenant. What does the blood of the new covenant do? The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all unrighteousness, the Bible says. And here the word says, come let us argue, says the Lord. Even if your sin are as red as scarlet, I will make them as white as snow. Have I not spoken to you? Have I not said these words to you? Even if your sin is as red as scarlet, I will make it as white as snow. What does it simply mean? If you are still guilt-ridden, you know, if the devil is condemning you, you know, with what has happened in your past, and if he's trying to, you know, pull you down by reminding you of your past mistakes, the Lord says, have I not said these words to you? Come, let us argue, says the Lord. Yes, your sin are as red as scarlet, but my blood can wash you off. You know, it can remove all those transgressions away from you, and you will be made as white as snow. There is another powerful, wonderful verse of scripture in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12. Let me read it for you. You know, what does the Lord say? Whatever He says, those are the words that bring about wonderful change in our lives. Those are the words that bring about strength and courage that will help us to overcome fear and condemnation. Read that word together with me. For I will be merciful to their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. You know, there's another translation which goes like this. I will be merciful, and I will forgive their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. Have I not said these words to you? Have I not commanded these words to you? I will remember their sins no more. And when those sins God doesn't remember, but when you remember, when people remind you, and when the devil reminds you, you need to say what he has said. And what has God said? He said, I will remember those sins no more. Why does he not remember them? Because it has already been dealt with on the cross of Calvary. And he has removed our sins as far as east is from the west. So far has he removed all our transgressions from our lives. And that is why we celebrate communion. When we celebrate communion, we are saying, God has dealt with my sin. He remembers them no more. And that is why I do this in remembrance of him who has dealt with my sin on the cross of Calvary. Whenever things, you know, thoughts of guilt and thoughts of condemnation come into your mind, I want you to say these words. He doesn't remember. He remembers my sins no more because he has dealt with it on the cross of Calvary. Isaiah chapter 44 verse 1 onwards, you know, kind of talks about what God has said concerning our family. Let me read it for you. Isaiah 44, verse 1 onwards. But now listen, O Jacob, that is you and me, my servant and Israel, whom I have chosen. The Bible says in verse 2, thus says the Lord, who made you and formed you from the womb, who will help you. Do not fear, O Jacob, my servant, and Jeshurun, whom I have chosen. Verse 3, he says, for I will pour out water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. And listen to this, I will pour out my spirit on your offspring and my blessing on your descendants. Have I not spoken to you? Have I not commanded these words of promise? You know, if you are concerned about the future of your family and related aspects, they say, the Lord says, have I not spoken to you? I will pour out my spirit upon your descendants, and I will pour out my blessing on your offspring. Concerning our future, what does the Lord has already said? Come with me to Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 1. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Isaiah 45 and verse 1. Thus says the Lord to Cyrus. Cyrus is no longer here. You and I are here. We are reading this particular word of scripture. It is God who is speaking to us this very morning through this very scripture. His anointed, whom I have taken by the right hand to subdue nations before him, and to loose the loins of kings, to open doors before him, so that gates will not be shut. Verse 2, the Bible says, you know, I will go before you and make the rough places smooth. I will shatter the doors of bronze and cut through their iron bars. You know, if I could summarize the first two verses of scripture, the Bible says, I have taken you by your right hand, and I say to him, I will go before you and make the paths smooth for you. You know, future, what does it hold? How is it going to be? We don't know the nitty-gritties of it. But nevertheless, we can say it with faith in our hearts. My times are in the hand of God. And God has said, I have held you by your right hand. And I say to you, I will go before you and make the rough places smooth. You know, similar words God spoke to Moses. My presence will go before you and I will give you rest. Even on the first day of this month of November, God is speaking to our hearts. He says, I will go before you. I will give you rest. I have taken you by my right hand, and I say to you, I will go ahead and make those rough places smooth for you. Have I not spoken these words to you? Have I not commanded these words to you? Be strong. Be courageous. Don't be afraid. Don't be disgraced. Move forward, for I will be with you. Isaiah 48 and verse 17. Concerning the work of our hands, what does the Bible say? What has God already spoken? The Bible says, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. I am the Lord your God, who teaches you to profit, who leads you in the way you should go. What a wonderful, powerful word of God. Have I not spoken these words? I will teach you to profit. It doesn't matter that you are in the midst of a problem. It doesn't matter that you are going through a midst of a, you know, a dry patch, so to speak. I will teach you to profit. I will teach you what is best for you, says another translation. And have I not said these words? I will certainly fulfill those words in your life. Romans chapter 10 and verse 11. Again, a powerful word of God. The Bible says, for the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. Whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. That is what the Bible says. That is what God has said. And if your trust is in God this morning, if you're finding your rest in God this morning, the Bible says you will not be disappointed. He says, have I not told you? Have I not given you my word? Have I not given you these wonderful promises? It will always come to pass. You need to be strong. You need to be courageous and move forward. Not only have I given you my word, but I am going to be with you. And his very presence with us is the blessed assurance that his promise will always come to its fulfillment in each one of our lives. Even on the first day of this month, the Lord says, move forward, be strong, be courageous. Have I not given you my word? Have I not given you my promise? Now I'm going to give you my presence. I'm going to be with you. And you will see the demonstration of my power, bringing about my purposes in your life, leading you to peace and prosperity in Jesus Christ. Wherever you are, as you close your eyes together with me, let's lift our hands towards the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. You know, what a wonderful Savior we have. Have I not spoken to you? Have I not given you my word? Have I not given you my promise? It will always come to pass. It is His word, His promise that gives us the strength to be courageous, that gives us the strength to deal with our fears and to overcome our discouragement so that we can move forward, you know, as the Lord leads us from where we are to where He wants us to be. Would you raise your hands together with me as we look to God?
They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like the eagles in the sky. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. They shall walk and they shall walk and not faint. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like the eagles in the sky. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. They shall walk and they shall walk and not faint.
Father, we thank you this morning for your very presence. We thank you for your precious promises. We thank you for your awesome power. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege, Lord, of knowing you, for the privilege of being part of your plan. And we thank you, Lord, that you have sustained us this far and you will lead us to be successful, Lord, in fulfilling your will in our lives. We pray that, Lord, you will lead us, take us by our right hand, and you will lead us forward in this particular month. We thank you, Lord, that you are already, you are going ahead of us. Your presence goes before us so that we can experience the rest that only you can give. I declare the blessing of God to be upon your people. Meet every need according to your glorious riches. I pray, fill their hearts with courage. Fill their hearts with strength. Lord, bless the work of their hands. I pray the blessing of God, Lord, will fill their hearts, that their cup will run over and goodness and mercy shall follow them all the days of their life. Give you praise, honor, and glory because it all belongs to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. God's people say, amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. All God's people say, amen and amen. God be with you and God bless you.